Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. Words, words, words. My guest today is truly the Pied Piper of the future and of the beauty of words. He has written, "We have been given the gift of life, but forgotten to say thanks." My guest is Ray Bradbury. He has written, "Bradbury Speaks, Too Soon from the Cave, Too Far from the Stars. Essays on the Past, the Future, and Everything in Between," published by William Morrow. Welcome, Ray.
It's good to be here again. Thank you.
Thank you. You know, you're also the Pied Piper of the future.
Those are wonderful words, yeah.
Well, but it's true, and in reading this book, it begs to be said out loud.
Well, the great thing I've discovered over the years is that boys who don't read much read one of my books and become readers. And I'm so proud of that I'm helping teachers teach boys to read.
Any particular book of them that you would say, Martian Chronicles?
Yeah, the Martian Chronicles is their favorite.
But today happens to be your holiday.
That's
that
right.
We are taping, Halloween.
That's right.
And anybody who hasn't read The Halloween Tree should really, this is the day to pull it out and read it, either out loud or give it as a gift.
Oh, that's wonderful. Thank you.
Yeah. This is the one about the children and the boys, young boys who save a friend's life.
That's right. Well, you know, the book got written because 30 years ago, Charlie Brown and the Great Pumpkin was on TV, and my kids hated the show so much, they all ran over and kicked the set. And I was very unhappy too because the Great Pumpkin didn't show up. It's like having Santa Claus die on the way down the chimney. And the next day I had lunch with Chuck Jones, the animator, and he said, "Did you see Charlie Brown, the Great Pumpkin, last night?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Well, it wasn't very good, was it?" I said, "No, I love Charlie Brown, but," well, and Chuck then said, "Well, why don't we do a really good film on Halloween?" And I said, "Wait right there." And I went home and I brought a huge painting to him that I did of the Halloween tree with my kids a couple of years before. And Chuck looked at that and said, "My God, that's the history of Halloween. That's the whole genealogy. Will you write the screenplay?" So I wrote the screenplay for Chuck Jones, at which point MGM closed the animation unit and fired Chuck Jones and me. And I went out on the street with my screenplay and I turned it into a novel, which you have here now, The Halloween Tree.
That's happened a few times, which is part of some of the essays here.
Yeah.
Something Wicked This Way Comes.
That's right.
That began as a screenplay for Gene Kelly.
That's correct, yes, yeah. He was a very good friend and I loved his film so much that I said, walking home one night from MGM, from having seen one of his films, "My God, I'd do anything to work for Gene Kelly." My wife said, "For God's sake, go to the file, find a story, turn it into a treatment." And I found a story and turned it into a treatment and gave it to Gene Kelly. He says, "Wow, this is my next film. Can I take it to Paris and try to get some money?" And he came back a month later and he said, "I'm sorry, Ray, we couldn't get any money for your screenplay." I said, "Don't tell me you're sorry." I said, "Forget it." So I spent the next 5 years and turned the Gene Kelly screenplay into Something Wicked This Way Comes.
But then people, and again an essay here, Abe Lincoln's Doctor's Dog Butterfly. And that's where people will buy an author's work, you in particular, and the minute they do, they got to do something to ruin it.
They it's irresistible. I've had that happen again and again and again at the studios. Sometimes I have to make a little speech if I'm working for Hechtel Lancaster years ago. Before I started work, I said, "Look, I'll be here at 9 in the morning and till 5:30 in the afternoon, but please don't tell me what I'm doing because I don't want to know. Mm-hmm. And if you understand that, I'll be your employee. So that's the way I start out.
But the butterfly in this particular story is so important to the story they have bought, and they want to get rid of it.
Well, the director had been working on the film about a year, and then all of a sudden he said one afternoon, why don't we get rid of the butterfly? And I said, no, I tell you what, we'll get rid of the director instead. And they fired the director, who will remain nameless. We got a new director. Yep. And made the film.
And then there is a story of you with, I guess it was Houston, John Houston and Peter Vertell.
Yeah.
And there was a problem with the script. And you said, go home. Let's not fight anymore. Put a pencil and a pad of paper next to your bed. And
they didn't believe me. I said, look, my subconscious gives me answers. So if we all pose the question tonight, and tomorrow morning, when you wake up, either you or Peter or me will have the answer to the problem. And the next morning at 6 o'clock in the morning, the phone rang. It was John Houston saying, Ray, I've got the answer. You were right. And I said, you son of a bitch, don't ever question me again.
And you had a working also with a Russian director you meet at Lewis Milestone's house.
Yes.
And he goes through the line and he hears your name and he doesn't want to meet anybody else. He sits with you and drinks vodka.
Well, it's an embarrassing story because it's self-serving and I haven't told many people about it.
That's one of the previously unpublished essays.
That's right, yes.
What happened?
Well, the director was Bunderchuk, who did War and Peace. And they had all these directors there, all the important directors at Lewis Milestone's house. John Ford, William Wyler, yeah. Billy Wilder, you name it. And they were all there in a line, and Bunderchuk went along the line and said, oh, Mr. Ford, a pleasure, and Mr. Wyler, a pleasure. And it came to the end of the line, I was just standing there like a witness to the whole thing. And all of a sudden, when he heard my name, he cried, oh, Bradbury! And he swarmed over me and showered me with kisses and dragged me over in a corner and got out a bottle of vodka and drank me under the table. And all the directors are standing there wondering, who is that terrible man there with Bunderchuk? And it was me.
Another film that was made, Fahrenheit 451, you have also read out loud the audio tape on it.
That's right.
But since that time, it's had another life and another life, and here it is being reissued. You weren't that happy with the first version.
Well, there were some missing things.
Yeah.
They left out the mechanical hound, which is very important metaphor, and they neglected the girl next door, and they had an older woman, and they cast that part with the same actress.
Julie Christie played parts.
And it was a mistake to me.
Yeah.
But I liked Oscar Werner very much in the lead. He was excellent.
But since then, Mel Gibson has taken it, and then somebody else wrote a screenplay, and now it's finally going to be made by someone else again.
Well, Frank Darabont has done the screenplay and he's going to direct, but our problem is getting the money to make the film. So Mel Gibson has pulled back from producing it. So we're looking for someone now to give us the money.
Well, somebody should, is all I can say. You talked too about friendship and a man named Norman Corwin,
yeah,
who was at that point king of radio.
That's right. Well, when I was 27 years old, I published my first book of short stories, Dark Carnival. And I was working at MGM and CBS on occasion. And I talked to one of the secretaries there, and I said, I want to get in touch with my hero, Norman Corwin. And do you have an address? She said, no, we don't do that. We can't do that. And I said, oh, you've got to give me his address. So she slipped the address to me, and I wrote to Norman Corwin and sent him my book of short stories. And in my note to him, I said, look, if you love this book half as much as I love you, I want to take you to lunch someday. And he called me 3 days later and said, you're not taking me to lunch, I'm taking you to dinner.
Yeah.
And we've been friends for the last 40 years as a result of that.
And he also was the one who, in a way, made you go to New York.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, my wife was pregnant in 1949. We had no money. We had $40 in the bank. And Norman Corman said, you've got to come to New York and let people know that you exist. He said, I'll be in New York in June and with my wife, and we'll show you around and protect you. So bring your manuscripts with you, and maybe you'll find someone to publish your book. So I got on the Greyhound bus and went to New York 4 days and four nights and stayed at the YMCA, 50 cents a night. That's how poor I was. And had a whole week to show my manuscripts to people, but nobody wanted them. People kept saying, don't you have a novel? I said, no, I'm a short story writer. But the last night, I was ready to go back to L.A. to my pregnant wife, and I had dinner with Walter Bradbury, no relation, the editor at Doubleday. And during dinner, he said to me, I think you've written a book and you don't know it. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, what about all those Martian stories that you've been writing in the pulp magazines for $20 a piece? Huh? What if you tied all these stories together in a tapestry? Wouldn't they make a book called The Martian Chronicles? I said, oh my God. He says, why do you say, oh my God? I said, because when I was 24, I read Winesburg, Ohio,
yeah.
And I was madly in love with that book. And I thought to myself, oh God, if someday I could write a book like Winesburg, Ohio, but Layla on Mars.
Yeah.
And I put that note aside and forgot about it. And over a period of years, wrote my Martian stories. And Walter Bradbury said, go back to the YMCA tonight, write an outline, bring it to the office tomorrow. If it's any good, I'll give you $700. So I stayed up all night in the Y, wrote the outline, took it in, and Walter Bradbury said, here's your $700. And then he said, now, don't you have another idea that you can give me that we can kid people into thinking it's a novel? I said, well, I've got a story about a man with tattoos all over his body. And when he perspires at night, his tattoos come alive and tell their stories. And Walter Bradbury said, here's another $700. So I sold the Martian Chronicles and the Illustrated Man on the same day and went home rich to my pregnant wife.
And the rest is history, because here is the Martian Chronicles.
That's right.
And I should say, last Saturday night, four of Ray Bradbury's plays were done, one of which was about a young couple on Mars.
That's right.
And it's not unlike sort of the story you talk about in Bradbury Speaks.
That's right, yes.
Yeah, because you said, at one point I dreamt about a woman on Mars who wakes up to have an astronaut near her, and he wants to take her back to Earth. There's also the part of Ray Bradbury that has sort of commercialized, publicized the wonderful world of Mars. And I'm holding up the Grand Tour, A Traveler's Guide to the Solar System. But it was also when the men landed on the moon that it was as if there was a touch from heaven.
It was one of the greatest nights in my life, and it was the greatest night in the history of the world.
And you were in London. I love the story you tell in Bradbury Speaks. You're there in London, and you're saying this to the eminent Sir David Frost now. And he says,
well, he misunderstood the evening. And at the start of the evening, when we landed on the moon, and David Frost said to the audience, I have with me an American genius tonight, going to interview him, and I thought, it's got to be me. And he says, and here he is, Engelbert Humperdinck. And I couldn't believe it. On Engelbert Humperdinck, on the night we landed on the moon. So I walked off the show, and I went out in the parking lot, and the producer came running out. He said, what are you doing out here? I said, I'm looking for a taxi. That man there doesn't understand this is the greatest night in the history of the world. So get me a taxi. I got a taxi, went across London, and did a show with Mike Wallace and Walter Cronkite on Telstar to tell people how important landing on the moon was. And I stayed up all night after that. I walked across London crying. I cried all night. I was so happy.
Yeah. The astronauts and NASA, you've played a role with them.
Well, yes, of course, yeah.
Yeah. There's a wonderful book that they all did called The Home Planet that, Lauren Acton has been very instrumental in. I think there's something so glorious about the whole concept of going to the moon, and I think it's been a crime that we haven't gone back again too often.
It's a shame we ever left.
Yeah.
And it should be a base. We don't need something between. We need the moon as a base, and then we go off to Mars.
You have an essay here called The Affluence of Despair. Very important, really wonderful, that I have to say, how come we're one of the greatest nations in the world and yet this feeling of doom? And you wrote that in 1998.
That's right.
Yeah, this whole essay.
And we're still afflicted with that. We don't think much of ourselves. And I think it's because of our TV media that downgrades everything, and we pay attention to the negative things, and people come away feeling it's not worth living. And so I wrote the essay to counteract that.
Yeah. You also spoke in that part and in another essay about speaking to the special effects people, that everything is booming and violence and bombing, but where's the story?
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, most of the films today are, they burn 10 billion gallons of gasoline every 2 minutes. They're afraid they're going to bore you, and as a result, they bore you.
Yeah, yeah. Explosions do not take the place of heart.
That's right.
Yeah.
And there are good films around, but they're on late night TV on cable. So I love to surf the cable late at night and find the really good movies.
Yeah. Where people weren't afraid to talk.
That's right.
I said in the beginning, you know how to, the perfect word. I mean, even when you met, Lord Russell.
Yeah.
Bertrand Russell. And he had written short stories.
That's right.
Now, you didn't say they were mediocre. You said they were moderately developed. And that word moderate, immediately the reader knows how you feel.
That's right, yes. My friendship with him turned out very well. And because I brought that up on my way out to his home in London, it scared the heck out of me because I thought I'm meeting Bertrand Russell, the greatest philosopher in the world that evening. What shall I say to him? And when I arrived at his doorstep, I suddenly remembered his short stories. And I was one of the few people in the world that bought his short stories.
Yeah. And you had said you knew if he ever did write short stories, it would be in a science fiction sort of out-of-world type.
That's right, yes.
But you said the execution was moderate.
That's right.
And his wife looks at you and says, you're being much too naive. Or your naivete is overwhelming.
That's true, yeah. She was a sweetie.
Yeah. Talk about meeting people overseas, because you always had to take a boat until, 1982?
That's right, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What was the fear?
I really wasn't afraid of flying. I was afraid of myself, but I didn't know. This is good information I'd like to give people who are afraid of flying. Examine yourself and find out if it isn't really you. I was afraid I'd run up and down the aisle and say, stop the jet. And when that didn't happen, I began to fly every week and every month and every year.
And it ended with your saying in that essay, now you're ready to drive a car, because people should know Ray Bradbury does not drive cars.
Well, that's a different thing. I grew up poor, and when Maggie and I got married, we couldn't afford a telephone, we couldn't afford a car. And it was 10 years before we could afford a car. And I let Maggie become the driver, and I was the passenger.
Yeah, she was the designated
driver.
Absolutely,
yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. In the book, too, you talk about the night you are there giving an award to Steven Spielberg. And you stop it because over at that table is George Burns.
That's right. Well, when I was 14 years old, I used to attend the Burns and Allen radio show, and I loved them so much that in typing class at Berendo Junior High School, I wrote scripts for Burns and Allen and gave them to George Burns every Wednesday night and down at the Figueroa Street Playhouse. And he accepted these scripts and told me I was a genius, that I was only 14 and writing very lousy scripts. And he was very sweet to me. So 40 years later, I was at this awards banquet with Steven Spielberg, and I looked over in the corner, and there's George Burns at a table, and I stopped everything. I said, I mean, I'll give Spielberg his award in a moment, but right now I want to give my personal award to a man who was so sweet and good to me when I was 14 and told me I was going to make it somehow. And when the show was over, George Burns came running up to me. He said, "Was that you? Was that you? I remember you." And we embraced for the first time in 40 years.
Ray, in looking and getting these essays together, how have you changed? I mean, are you the same? You can't be the same person who wrote something in 1982 or 98 that you are today.
No, things strike me like lightning. I get an idea, and I write it in an hour. So suddenly I'm provoked by something. So I don't think I've changed. I wait for the surprise.
Yeah.
And if I'm surprised by something, then I write it.
Are you a fast typist?
Oh, I write 120 words a minute, yeah.
Oh, you are. And yet no computer?
Well, a computer's a typewriter.
Yeah.
And I have 5 typewriters, so I don't need another one.
Uh-huh. There's a wonderful essay, again, that had never been published called Mouser. And it is about you being at, I think, Saks or Magnets, and you see the man with the mustache and gifts, and you go, Walt Disney. And he says, Ray Bradbury. And you say, when can I get together with you? He says, tomorrow for lunch.
That's right. It was the first time in my life that anyone ever said tomorrow instead of next week or next month or next year. But Walt Disney said tomorrow. And the next day I was at lunch with Walt Disney, my hero, and we became very good friends.
Yeah. And it was interesting too, he took you out to Disney Studios.
Yeah.
And at the end he thanked you, I guess you had worked on some things with him. He says, what can I do for you? And you said, open the vaults.
That's right.
And you took all those cells and everything you could carry home, and they didn't realize at that point what those would be so valuable today.
That had changed. Now, Steven Spielberg ruined the market because he began to pay $100,000 for cells.
Yeah. Where are they now? Still in your basement?
No, in my closet, yeah.
In your closet. Other part of that story, which I thought was very touching, the day he died, somebody called your wife and said, where's Ray? And she said, he's taking the 4 daughters to Disneyland.
That's right. And when I came home, I found out, I wept because I hadn't planned the trip to Disneyland knowing that Walt would be dead.
Yeah.
Having them call and ask for me when I was there.
And yet, it's lovely. You call him the demon of happiness.
That's true. That's true.
Yeah. Lovely part of this. Actually, the book, as I said, it begs to be read out loud, such as The Future with a Funny Name. How do you spell the future to make sure it happens in the right way? How do you stop 1984 from ever arriving? And how do you freeze Big Brother in his tracks? Very pertinent, as pertinent today as it would have been when you wrote it.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yeah, and each and every one of these, as I read it, I could hear a voice in my head saying, read it out loud, Connie. And whose voice was that? Ray Bradbury.
Oh, thank you. That's wonderful.
Thank you very much, Ray.
What a pleasure.
Will you autograph my book?
Sure will.
And I have a special pen that I know you will like. And it has the sort of, here you are.
Wonderful.
And if you would like a copy of our newsletter, Good Books, send me a stamped, self-addressed envelope to Good Books, P.O. Box 69-1640, Los Angeles, California, 90069. Look for our column in the Beverly Hills Courier, for us on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. Program is streamed. It's part of Today's World Streaming. And you can email me, too, at talksbooks@lycos.com. We'll tell you about some other books we've liked recently. Have to show you The Cat's Pajamas, Ray Bradbury, and he just told me he designed this cover. Ray Bradbury is known for collecting cats. And also this other book, again, The Grand Tour, The Celestial Beings, and support your local library. Whatever you can do, keep the library alive, and we'll see you next time. Thank you, Ray.
Real pleasure.
Thank you, Doug.
Thank you.